better? I said, isn't that better? And Jeremiah, if you quit when a better ministry is coming, just because of the disappointment of the past, when the better days are here, and then you are hearing stories, then if you are not careful, because of shame, you might not be able to come back. But thank God you have not gone. Thank God you are still here. And the better days will meet you here. And the better experiences will meet you here. And the greater thing the Lord is doing, it started already, and you are here when it's starting. Until it finishes and completes, you will still be there. And that's what encouraged Jeremiah to say, oh Lord, if that is the case, I'm not running away again. I'm not abandoning the ministry again. I am there. I am there. Thank God I am here too. I said, thank God I am here too. And the Lord will keep you stable in Jesus' name. And that's what he had. Then let's look at Jeremiah chapter 32. We're looking at verse 39. Our confidence in God's promises. In Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 39. And I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever, for the good of them and of their children after them. A part of the problem of Jeremiah was this. Jeremiah had a few people like Baruch, like Zedekiah, like others that supported him. Then some of the princes of Israel, they say, no, away with Jeremiah. He's not worthy to live. Kill him off. And then he was turning between two. When he came to this side, Jeremiah, go ahead, you're doing well. When he came to this, the same Israel, they'll say, no, you're bad fellow. You don't have any love for us. You are supporting Babylon and Nebuchadnezzar. And then he said, oh Lord, I'm tired of this division. I'm tired of this confusion and the conflict. When am I going to stop having all this conflict? And then God Almighty said, now I will give them one heart. The division you saw yesterday, you will not see today. And the breaking up you saw yesterday, you will not see today. You know, there are people, they've been looking at the church, and they have been saying, I'm not sure, I'm here today, I'm not sure what I'm going to be here tomorrow. Why? Because I'm confused. Look at this side fighting against this side, and look at this other side throwing stones at this other side. Look at what I'm hearing from this area, and then when I go to this area, I hear another thing. Look at this local church, and look at all the differences and the conflicts. I don't want to stay in this place anymore. But God is going to give us one heart. It's going to give us one way. It's going to give us one word. And then we move in the same direction. Why are you going to leave before the better days come? Those good days will meet me here. I said, he'll meet me here. And that's what encouraged Jeremiah. When God said to Jeremiah, I will give them one heart, and I will give them one way, that they may fear me forever, for the good of them and of their children after them. In verse 40, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them, that I will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their hearts, that they shall not depart from me. We will not backslide again. Or not depart from the Lord anymore. And that's what now encouraged Jeremiah. And then Jeremiah said, if that is the case, then I can stay. And I'm going to stay. I said, I'm going to stay. Jeremiah chapter 33, and I'm reading from verse 3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee. That's good. Call unto me, Jeremiah. What problems do you have? What challenges do you have? What burdens do you have? And you are thinking, maybe I'm through. And the Lord is now saying, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. You know, there are some things you've never seen in your life, you'll begin to see. There are some breakthroughs you have been dreaming about and thinking about, you've never had, you'll begin to have. And because God said, I will show you things that it will surprise you. And you will be surprised that something like this can happen to even you. Something is going to happen. In verse 6, behold, I will bring it health and cure. I will cure them, and I will reveal unto them the abundance of peace. peace and truth. Our confidence in God's promises. And that's what encouraged Jeremiah. And Jeremiah said, now I understand. Is there anything too hard for me? That same chapter 33. That is Jeremiah chapter 33. Look at verse 8. In verse 8, I will cleanse them from all their iniquity, whereby they have sinned against me. I will pardon all their iniquities, whereby they have sinned, and whereby they have transgressed against me. The Lord will forgive. He will cleanse all the sins away. Guilt, condemnation, everything will pass away. Verse 14, behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised. Any promise you are holding on to, and you prayed, you fasted, and those promises have eluded you, and you've not seen the fulfillment. Now God says, behold, the days come, that says the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised unto the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. Since he said he's going to do it, he's going to do it. Because he has the power. He will fulfill it in your life, in my life, in Jesus' name. Number one, the question among God's people. Number two, the comprehension of God's promises. Number three, our confidence in his glorious power. Our confidence in his glorious power. The power of the Lord is mighty and glorious. Everything the Lord has promised to do, he has the power to do. And from this day, he'll begin to do it. And you'll see the evidence in your life, even from today, in Jesus' name. Exodus chapter 15. Exodus chapter 15. We're reading from verse 6 and verse 26. Exodus chapter 15, verse 6. Our confidence in his glorious power. The right hand, thy right hand, O Lord, is become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, has dashed in pieces the enemy. Our enemies are defeated. I said your enemies are defeated. It says in verse 26, and said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and do that which is right in his sight, and give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of those diseases upon thee which I have brought upon the Egyptians. Any disease upon the Egyptians will not be upon you in Jesus' name. You know what I've discovered? I've discovered that those who don't know the Lord, there are some peculiar diseases they have because of their lifestyle, because of the things they do, because of their covenant with the evil one. And you are not in covenant with the evil one. Am I right? And you are not part of them in the world. Am I right? If you are not taking part in their sin, you'll not take part in their suffering. If you are not taking part in their evil, you'll not take part in the demons that are afflicting them. And he says, all those diseases upon the Egyptians, I will not bring them upon you. And if you have any disease upon you that looks like, this one looks like an Egyptian disease, this one is an Asian flu, and I'm not an Asian, I'm a Christian. This one looks like a Nigerian calamity, and I'm not number one Nigerian. Who am I? I'm a Christian. I belong to the kingdom of God. And because of where I belong, therefore all those things that happen to the outsiders will not happen to the insider. I'm not an outsider. I said I'm not an outsider. I am a member of the body of Christ in the kingdom of God. I'm a citizen of the kingdom of God. And anything happening to those people outside the kingdom, watch me very well, and I look at you very well, it will not be upon you, it will not be upon me. Because we are inside. The disease of the outsider will not come upon your life. And then he says, I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord that healeth thee. Are you healed? I said, are you healed? And you know, it doesn't take any sweating. You know, I was in an interview yesterday, and the person interviewing me said, looks like, you know, when you want to pray, other people, when they want to pray, they jump and they run and they beat the air. And he says they do acrobatic or something. I said, no, it's sincere than that. It's the name of Jesus, it's not a jumping. It's the power of the Holy Ghost, it's not acrobatic display. And today, once we just mentioned disease, your life vanish away. Before you open your eyes, it's gone. Yeah. And all those things, and you know, without sweating and without fighting anything, because Jesus fought the battle on the cross of Calvary. And because he won your case already, no hassle, no problem, and there's no difficulty anymore, and the Lord has healed you in Jesus' name. And so he says, I will not bring those diseases upon you which I brought upon the Egyptians. I am the Lord that healeth thee. We're looking at Deuteronomy chapter 23. Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 5. It says, nevertheless, the Lord thy God will not hearken unto Balaam. Any Balaam that is hired against you and they want to destroy your life, the Lord will not listen to them. I said, the Lord will not listen to them. He said, nevertheless, the Lord thy God will not hearken unto Balaam, but the Lord thy God turned the curse into a blessing unto thee, because the Lord thy God loved thee. Every curse is turned to a blessing. Because the power of God is a glorious power, and is going to use that glorious power to deliver you from every attack and every evil in Jesus' name. Numbers chapter 23. Numbers chapter 23. Our confidence in God's power. Our confidence in his glorious power. In Numbers chapter 23, verse 19, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he shall repent. As he said, and shall he not do it? As he spoken, and shall he not make it good? Behold, I have received commandment to bless, and he has blessed, and I cannot reverse it. The blessing of God upon your life today will never be reversed. Because of the power of God, you know that today you are in for blessing. And the blessing will come, it will be permanent in Jesus' name. In Luke chapter 18, Luke chapter 18, verse 27. Luke chapter 18, verse 27. And he said, the things which are impossible with men, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. Have you been told that something is impossible? You think that, you know, you want to have this, and the people in authority, or the people with knowledge, and the people with experience, they said, how can that be? That is impossible. I come to tell you today, it is possible here. Job chapter 42. Job chapter 42, reading from verse 2. I know that thou canst do everything. That's what you need to know. I know that you can do virtually everything. And everything in your life, the Lord will do it. And whatever the challenges are, you come to this same knowledge that Job came to. You see the problem. When the problem came on Job, he worshiped God, yes. He prayed to God, yes. And then all these friends came and engaged him in dialogue, in argument. You must have sinned. No, I didn't sin. I know my life. I love the Lord. And why is this upon you? Until Job came to the point, he said, friends, leave me alone. Go your way. You are not helping me. All your counseling, all your complaint, and all your argument is getting me deeper and deeper into the hole out of which I want to climb. Therefore, go your way. And then he came now to God, and God began to talk to him. And then he said, God, you know what? Now I know. No argument again. If I don't understand this, understand that, why this happened, why that happened, I'm not going to bother myself again. One thing I know. You can do all things. That was the chapter and the day when all his problems are solved. Stop the argument and stop the reasoning. and stop all the discussion with the people that don't understand your situation, and then analyzing and figuring out and this and that. And the more we figure out, the more confusion we have. No more argument again. One thing I know today, God can do everything. And God will do everything. And this, the day you come to that realization, the chapter that tells you that you are, that you know that God can do everything, that's the chapter that is going to make you have the victory in Jesus' name. And you'll find that in verse 12, so the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. And today I come to tell you, your latter end will be better than the beginning in Jesus' name. The darkness is gone. The clouds are gone. The confusion is gone. Now we're going to enjoy the bright day of the prosperity and the blessing of God in Jesus' name. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job than the beginning. And now we come to Psalm 62. Psalm 62. What are you doing from verse 11? Psalm 62 verse 11. God has spoken once, and twice have I heard this, that power belongeth unto God. And this God is my Father. I said he is my Father. And power belongs unto him. Because of that, today, something good is beginning in our lives. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20. Now unto him that is able. Is your God able? Look at Abraham before the Almighty God. All you need to know, God is able. Look at the children of Israel before the Red Sea. As they were thinking they were going to drown, all they needed to know, God is able. Look at the children of Israel on the walls of Jericho. All they needed to know without shooting any gun is that our God is able. And look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego just before the furnace of fire. All we need to know is that God is able. Look at Daniel before the lion's den. All you need to know is that God is able. And look at the children, the disciples of Christ, as were behind the closed door, as if those Pharisees and Sadducees and the council and the Sanhedrin, as if they were the Almighty, as if they had the final say and the final decision in the life of everyone. But all that you need to know, disciple, is that God is able. And as you come to that realization this morning or this afternoon, I believe things are going to change. Now unto him that is able, able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. We're going to pray. And before we pray, you know, sometimes when you are praying, you say something, oh God, this is what I want you to do for me. All of a sudden, in your heart, you say, am I not asking too much? Is that